Thank you, Jian Yu, for the kind introduction. That also, of course, thanks for having me here. Thanks for the invitation, but I come back to this later. I will, as you know, just talk about one exhibition, Hello World, that took place at the Auer Museum this summer and was our reflection on the conditions of art in a globalized world and what this means for a museum collection. Given that a museum's collection is the foundation on which the institution rests, museum work is always, almost by definition, based on its collections. The composition and character of the museum collection, in turn, is the result of political and cultural conditions, which are themselves only ever subject to change and today increasingly shaped by the forces of globalization. When this term, globalization, first came into general usage in the 1980s, it denoted the unrestrained capitalist liberalization of trading standardized products on markets all over the world. Today, in the age of the internet, globalization affects and shapes all eras of life. While its advocates staunchly maintain that economic globalization creates a situation which everyone, including poorer nations, stands to gain from, its critics see it creating new forms of neoliberal exploitation and subjugation. Without wishing to take sides in this controversy in this lecture, but if you want to have an argument in this discussion, I recommend to go to see the great Harun Farocki show in the last part. So without me taking any argument in this documentation, it may safely be said that cultural development has never been a homogeneous process. Globalization certainly enhances and accelerates the exchange of viewpoints, aesthetic judgments, and artistic concepts. The question of what a globalized narrative of art history might look like, which takes these developments into account, has been a focus of the discipline over the last few decades, as well as biennials, museums, exhibition projects, and symposiums like this one show. While a global art history might provide a platform for multifaceted transcultural and post-colonial perspectives on works of art, as well as supporting hybrid artistic approaches, there's a very real danger that such an enterprise cannot escape the conditions of Western art history. After all, that history is closely linked to the primarily Western dominance over the political and economic expansion of globalization. What has emerged since then is an awareness of the world as polycentric. There's no longer any place for traditional alignments, universal claims, and autonomy in matters of interpretation. Rare in this process of contestation, the museum and its collections position itself is one of the most important challenges of our time. From April 28th to August 26, 2018, the Nationalgalerie im Hamburger Bahnhof Museum für Gegenwart Berlin reflected on these questions by representing the exhibition Hello World, Revising a Collection. The show was a critical inquiry into the collection of the Nationalgalerie and its predominantly Western focus. It tried to examine how its scope could be broadened by combining non-Western artistic tendencies and a transcultural approach. Instead of constructing a linear history, as it happened of 20th and 21st century art, individual works and groups of works provided points of departure for a wide range of different narratives. The interplay resulted in 13 multifaceted chapters unfolding in the exhibition, ranging from the tracement of vestige of history to the associative intertwined of thought lines and pictorial worlds. Each part was focused on moments of transcultural exchange and artistic collaboration, and offered insights into the process of operation and transformation, which informs ideas, attitude, and object. The exhibition Hello World is part of the ongoing initiative Global Museum by the German Federal Cultural Foundation, which furthermore is funding projects examining the history of modern art from a global perspective by the Kunsthalle Nordrhein-Westfalen in Düsseldorf, the MMK in Frankfurt, and the Lehnbach House in Munich. To get a better understanding of this effort, it is crucial to reflect the history of the Nationalgalerie or National Gallery. Its foundation, this is the Hamburger Bahnhof, by the way, its foundation was based on the donation of a private collection in 1861 to the Prussian state, which dates back to a time when there was no such thing as a German nation. In 1976, the National Gallery was given its first home in Friedrich August Schüler's temple-like building on Berlin's Museum Island, which beginnings go back as far as 1830. The inscription of the tympanon, what you here see, says, "To German art, 1871, establishes beyond doubt that the museum was meant to serve the art of the nation, while referring to the foundation of the German Reich in the wake of the Franco-Prussian War of 1871. This appeal to patriotism or nationalism was enhanced in 1886 when an equestrian statue of Prussian's King Friedrich Wilhelm IV was installed on the steps leading up to the building. This national orientation has repeated sparked discussion about the definition and role of German art and the real mission of the National Gallery. In actuality, the development of the institution reflects upon the ups and downs of German history. The Nazis classified large sections of the collection of modern art as degenerated and removed or even destroyed these artworks. After World War II, Germany's division in formation of two blocks left their traces on the institution, while the National Gallery in the west of Berlin shifted its attention to Western European and North American art. That is the Neue Nationalgalerie, which you see above, the building by Mies van der Rohe. The focus of the collection of the National Gallery located in the eastern part of the city, that is the Alte National, was the Alte Nationalgalerie, was primarily on art created in and for the socialist GBR. Today, the National Gallery comprises five museums: Alte Nationalgalerie, Neue Nationalgalerie, Museum Berggruben, Sammlungsschaft Gerstenberg, and Hamburger Bahnhof Museum für Gegenwart Berlin. The exhibition Hello World aimed to reflect the character of the collection marked by these complexities and multiple ruptures. Furthermore, the National Gallery is part of two larger structures, the Staatliche Museen zu Berlin, which consists of 10 additional museums and an art library. It sees itself as a universal museum that is spread over several sites across Berlin. To make it even more complicated, this complex of museum is part of another umbrella organization, the Stiftung Preußischer Kulturbesitz, Prussian Cultural Heritage Foundation, established in 1957 to preserve and expand on the cultural legacy of the former state of Prussia. The Prussian Cultural Heritage Foundation presides over Berlin's State Library, archives of the former state of Prussia, the Ibero-American Institute, and the Staatliche Institut für Musikforschung and its Museum for Musical Instruments. The foundation is the largest employer in the cultural field in Germany. It is directly responsible to the German government and it's shaped by Germany's federal structure. The federal government and all 16 states of Germany support and finance it jointly. The exhibition Hello World drew from works from its own collection, but also included artifacts from other museums, libraries and archives of the Prussian Cultural Heritage Foundation. More than 200 artworks from the holdings of the National Gallery were supplemented with approximately 150 works on loan from other collections of the Staatliche Museen zu Berlin and the Stiftung Preußischer Kulturbesitz, including the Ethnological Museum, Art Library, Graphic Cabinet, Museum for Asiatic Art, Central Archives, etc., etc. In addition, 400 artworks, magazines and documents are presented in the exhibition from other national and international collections. All in all, the show features works of more than 250 artists. The Hello World project took two intensive years in the making. In preparation, we hosted a two-day conference, the idea of the Global Museum, in 2016, for which we invited colleagues from different international museums and institutions and asked for their view. The final exhibition was the result of teamwork in which the curators from the National Gallery developed the exhibition concept through regular meetings, roundtables, group workshops. Furthermore, the external colleagues Zdenka Badovinac, Clementine Delis, Natasha Genvala and Azu Vakbogu were invited to contribute widely divergent ways of thinking and developing curatorial concepts. In the current climate of a new nationalism and revisionist ideologies that also affects Germans' political discussion, Hello World was our way of positioning ourselves as a museum that literally play host to the world, championing openness, complexity, and diversity against simplification, homogenization, and narrow-mindedness. By challenging the canon, art historical as well as political hierarchies were made visible in order to break them. By furthermore addressing historical issues like oppression and colonialism, exile and migration, othering and discrimination, we offered perspective on the past in order to discuss problems of today. The exhibition took place in the entire space of Hamburger Bahnhof on its 10,000 square meter and consisted of the following chapters. This is the starting point, Agora, curated by our director Udo Kittelmann in the historic hall of the Hamburger Bahnhof. Using the analogy of Agora as a public meeting place, works by Zia Amadjani, Goshka Makua, Bruce Nauman, Marietta Potrich, among others, opened up the wide range of perspective on the condition of living together in a globalized world. Where do we come from? Adapting cultural forms, also curated by Udo Kittelmann. By retracing the artistic appropriation of the forms of indigenous objects that colonialism brought to Europe, the notion of originality, a central postulate of the classical avant-garde, was examined and put to test in relation to its break with the formal ideas of classical antiquity. Making paradise, places of longing, from Paul Gauguin to Tita Salina, curated by Anna Katharina Gebers. Starting with Orientalism and exorcist painting from the age of imperialism, Making Paradise traces the roots and contacts between artists that led from Peter Maha, that's an artist cooperative, Walter Spies and Bali's own transformation into a place of longing in the 1930s to contemporary art in Indonesia. Platforms of the Avantgarde, Der Sturm in Berlin, curated by the head of Hamburger Bahnhof, Gabriele Knapstein. Herwartswalden, Der Sturm Gallery, found in 1920, inspired Japanese artists at the beginning of the 1920s, such as Tomoyoshi Muramaya. After coming into contact with artistic trends and publications of the European avant-garde, he co-founded the artist group Mavo, establishing an early transnational network of artists. Entangled Histories, Arte Popular, Surrealism and Emotional Architecture, curated by Melanie Gormigier. In post-revolutionary Mexico in the 1920s, Arte Popular, the interplay of indigenous cultural techniques, crafts, tradition and art, gave off strong impulses that had a lasting effect on the artists of the international avant-garde and especially on surrealism. Predecessors and Descendants, Pictorial Culture Worlds of North America, again curated by Udo Kittelmann. In recent decades, the Ethnological Museum in Berlin has acquired works by contemporary North American artists. A selection of these acquisitions was shown in dialogue with works by artists of the early avant-garde in New York, with their reference to Native American image culture. Arrival, Incision, Indian Modernism as a Peripatic Itinerary, created by Natasha Ginwala. I come on that later. Portable Homeland, Fields to Factory, curated by Clementine Dillis. Works by Heinrich Vogler, which is a well-known German Art Nouveau artist who became politicized in the 1920s and lived in a community. Works by Heinrich Vogler, including his visual manifestos for Cumanism and emigration to the Caucasus, a set of a dialogue on survivalism and communal existence that traveled across time and space, beginning with Vogler's painting and historic publishing organs printed in the worldwide Armenian diaspora. The chapter ended with experimental artworks developed during the International Dilijan Arts Observatory in Armenia in 2016. Sites of Sustainability, Pavilions, Manifestas and Crypts, curated by Zdenka Badovinac. Artist initiatives and collaborative groups that originated in former Yugoslavia, the Soviet Union, Hungary, Poland and the GDR from the 1950s and to the 1980s created models of cultural productions that included alternative spaces, autonomous economies, self-historization and local international networks. Communication as Global Happening, Performance Art, Concept Art, Media Art, curated by Gabriele Knapstein and Melanie Romigier. I come also back to that chapter later, but it's a chapter that is very much based on mail art, telephone art and radio in the 1960s, also behind the idea of global communication. And the Human Rights of the Eye, a pictorial atlas of the Marx collection curated by former head of Hamburger Bahnhof Eugen Blume and Nina Schallenberg. This section of the exhibition pointed out cultural and socio-political associations between works from the Marx collections, for instance by Joseph Beuys, Robert Rauschenberg and Andy Warhol. Tableaus that associatively trace these connections have been developed in close cooperation with an artist design duo Sian. And my part, Kolumental, The Violence of Intimate History, I curated with Azu Vakbogu. I come to that later. And the last one, Red, Yellow and Blue Around the World, again curated by Udo Kittelmann. The National Gallery views Barnett Newman, Who's Afraid of Red, Yellow and Blue, that is in our collection, as a bridge between the US and Europe. Primary colors and their strong ties to the style and Bauhaus can be understood as a universal expression of a new era. Contemporary Chinese artist Liu Ye has drawn upon a new in the series of book paintings. The exhibition was complemented by six interludes that included works from the collection by Joseph Beuys, Ilya Kavakov on Kavara, which you see here, Keiichi Tanami and Quinn Yu Finn, as well as a public space dedicated to the unfinished glossary, Host 11 concept offer alternative approaches to explore the exhibition's diverse topics. I come to that later. A key example of shifting the focus and creating a new narrative was how the works of Joseph Beuys were framed in the chapter Communication as Global Happening. The National Gallery has an important collection of main works by this influential German artist. When taking a look at the international relationships Beuys had, art historical research up to now was very much focused on his connections to the US, his friendship with Andy Warhol, and especially his performance I Like America and America Likes Me, which took place in René Bloch's gallery in New York in 1974. Of course, Beuys is famous for his land art project 7000 Oaks, City Forestation instead of City Administration, that he started at Documenta 7 in 1982 in Kassel. His concept was to plant 7000 oak trees and place a basalt stone next to them. It took 5 years that all 7000 trees were planted. Last one was planted at Documenta 8 in 1987 at a time when Beuys already was dead. There's a work in the National Gallery that refers to this work, the installation that you see here, The End of the 20th Century from 1982-83. Joseph Beuys had the basalt steles that you see here extracted from an extinct volcano in northern Hessen. The steles stand for the origin and evolution of mankind, its future and history, including human interferences with nature. Beuys bought, I skip this a little bit here. Up to now, however, there was no awareness in Germany, in German art historical discourse, that Beuys' collaboration for Documenta 7, collaborated for Documenta 7 with Argentinian artist Nicolas García Uriburu, which you see in the back on the wall. In his work, Uriburu, from very early on, addressed the topic of the ecological and environmental issues. He was invited to the Venice Biennial in 1968, where he dyed the Canal Grande, Grand Canal green by using a pigment that reacts to microorganisms in the water. He repeated this project in New York, Paris and Buenos Aires, and adapted this concept to fountains and ports, this way also raising awareness for water pollution. In 1981, Uriburu colored the Rhine, one of the most polluted rivers in the world at that time. As Beuys also had an interest in environmental issues, he suggested to collaborate. They signed bottled water of the colored water of the Rhine, which you see in the back on the pedestal, donating the sales from this edition to environmental groups. Furthermore, Uriburu called trees already sculptures in 1971 in order to protect them. Beuys thus invited him to participate in 7000 Oaks as they shared obvious views on social education, nature and humanism. Nevertheless, García Uriburu does not appear in the list of Documenta artists. This neglecting continues in the reception in German art historical discourse, where he was equally not present for a long time, you can say up to the last 2 years. Another example would be a poster of German artist Wolf Vostell in the collection of the Kupferstich Cabinet, announcing a three-country happening in 1966 with Vostell himself, Alan Kaprow, and Marta Menuhin. Forstel was part of the Fluxus movement and is one of the pioneers of the happening. His electric decollage happening room from 1960 to 1982 is part of the collection of the National Gallery. In this work, Forstel refers to the reality of of 1968, the occupation of Czechoslovakia by Warsaw Pact forces and the US-led military operation in Vietnam. There's also connection to the National Gallery to Alan Kaprow. In 2015, the institution showed Fluids, a Happening by Alan Kaprow, 1967-2015. Fluids was first created in October 1967 at various public locations in California. With the assistance of volunteers, Kaprow built several structures measuring around 9 meters long, 3 meters wide, and 2.4 meters high, using ice blocks as his material. Once in place, these ice structures were simply left to melt. In its temporality and maturity, the work represents a challenge to the traditional understanding of art in public space. The work of Marta Minujín was not yet found in the collection of the National Gallery, neither in exhibitions, nor is she part of the collection. Concerning the three-country happening, this event has not been examined art historically in the work of Wolf Fussell at all. The happening was to take place simultaneously in New York, Berlin, and Buenos Aires. The original version considered the possibility of making use of the first commercial satellite, which provided direct and almost instant contact between Europe and North America via television, telephone, and telefax transmission. Forstel's drawing announces this first global artistic happening and shows a map of these three cities, each with concentric circles referring to the televisual transmission. Although neither Forstel nor Kaprow produced their part of the project, Minujín in Buenos Aires did record what they had proposed to ensure that the happening would be seen international as announced. Her work, Simultaneity in Simultaneity, consists of two parts. Firstly, a group of media personalities gathered at an audition were bombarded by television and film images, photographs, radio transmission, and others. Secondly, a group of individuals received phone calls at their home. If these examples offered different views on neglected positions and networks of art history and the absence of these positions in the collection of the National Gallery, Natasha Ginwala in her chapter had a different approach. In a rival incision, Indian Modernism as Peripatetic Itinerary, she follows three links in the collection by also involving works from the Museum for Asiatic Art. The starting point was a painting of Dada artist George Goss, which you see on the right side. The Pillars of Society from 1926 that she linked to caricatures from Indian artist Gagendranath Tagore from around the same period. Both artists developed irony and subversion to slice open the paradoxes of the political times as well as prevailing hypocrisies around social dogma and class division. While Gross launched a relentless critique and warning call against war and religious conservatism, Tagore inspected the mechanism of colonial power, caste hierarchy, and the daily impact of westernization in Bengal. Gagendranath Tagore was the nephew of renowned poet-philosopher Rabindranath Tagore, whose work was once part of the collection of the National Gallery. In 1929, Rabindranath Tagore decided to travel with 400 artworks to Europe. Upon arrival to Germany the following year, on a third visit to Berlin, an exhibition was held in Galerie Ferdinand Müller, where his work drew the admiration of many, including the director of the National Gallery, Ludwig Justi. After correspondence with Tagore, but due to shortage of funds, the donation of 5 watercolors ensued. His pictures were sized under the cleansing agenda of the Nazi regime, the disappearance and looting of artistic work classified as degenerated art. Ginwala's third point of departure is a collection of paintings from the 1960s onwards that the director of the Museum for Indian Art, Herbert Hertel, acquired. During his research travels to India, Hertel not only brought ancient Indian art, but also contemporary abstract painting by artists who are now part of the canon of Indian modernism. Nevertheless, the collection Hertel compiled for the museum remained somehow a secret. Quite tellingly, Ginwala found these pieces in the storage. instead of connecting the works to abstract expressionism under the influence of US-American Cold War politics, she showed that the artists were more interested in concept of Tantra and Indian philosophy, although some of them visited art school in Europe or had grants in the US. Against this backdrop, a new narrative of modernism evolved in Jinwala's display. The chapter I curated with Azu Wakbogu was somehow an exception to Hello World, also quite tellingly. Although there were numerous connections between artists from different African countries and Germany, as well as German art scene, and our collection contains hardly any works by modern or contemporary artists that are related to countries or thematic fields to the African continent. This exhibition chapter, therefore, was not based on the holdings of the National Gallery, but instead addressed an issue long neglected by the German public, but an urgent one nevertheless, and one that artists had never lost out of sight, the violent history of German and European colonialism, though through which the histories of countries on both continents are intimately bound together. Under the title Colomantle, four contemporary artists, Joel Andriano Mearisoga, Peggy Boot, Astrid S. Klein, and Dirk Schmidt, in critically reflecting on their own position, revealed the colonial mentalities which are still deeply rooted in today's mind, and they offered alternative strategies of empowerment. Especially the Division of the Earth tableau on the legal synopsis of the Berlin African Conference by Dirk Schmidt that you see here from 2007 had a very urgent topic. In his 15-part painting series, Schmidt refers to the 1984-1985 African Conference in Berlin, at which 13 European states and the United States came together to formulate regulations governing their territory interest on the African continent, which they largely considered ownerless. The General Act signed there provided the basis for the subsequent occupation of the country by the European imperial powers. This land grab involved the exploitation of the continent's natural resources and the expropriation and subjugation of the local population. In Namibia, German military forces carried out genocide against the Herero and Nama peoples between 1904 and 1998. With the continued denial of the nature of these events and the refusal to pay repatriation resulting in an ongoing legal conflict between these groups and the Federal Republic of Germany. This case formed the focus of Schmidt's work. Next to the painting, also the historical sources and political and legal documents to which they refer are displayed on a table for perusal. This that you see in the front. This material also includes the documentation of the law suite that members of the Herero fill out at the moment at a district court in New York against the German state for acknowledgement of this genocide. One of the key questions was how we could talk about the exhibition and its topic without falling back into establishing new hierarchies, finding new heroes and new centers. To avoid this trap, Daniela Bistron, the head of education, conceived the concept of an unfinished glossary based on the terms echo, influence, ghost, borders, and others. These 11 words formed a thematic grid with various vantage points from which to explore the 13 chapters of the exhibition. It was comprised of statements made by more than 30 international artists, academics, and practitioners who provided at least two different takes on each of the concepts listed above, I refer to. The polyphony amounting as it does to plurality and description for the terms, which are quite complex but at the same time deeply rooted in our everyday lives, expanded on and questioned the allegedly objective perspective represented by traditional museums and classic glossaries. The difference in the biographical and geographical backgrounds of the selected authors were relevant for their individual perspective. The unfinished glossary was designed as a space for reflection and outreach activities where visitors get a chance not only to read up onto different descriptions of key concepts, but to contribute their own statements as well. Furthermore, the terms provided the structure for the exhibition's accompanying program, which features films, screenings, workshops, talks, guided tour, and interventions. Of special interest was the exploration of the global relation of collection histories, the reception of art, the production of knowledge, perspective on categorization, and above all, questions concerning the structure and limits of collections and exhibitions. to reflect also the diversity of our audience and diversity of the city of Berlin, the educational program offered events in 6 languages, Arabic, German, Polish, English, Spanish and Turkish. Hello World got a lot of attention by scholars and colleagues from all over the world. A delegation of the National Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art in Seoul also visited the show. I assume that their stay led to my invitation, for which I thank you very much. We received mixed reviews for the show. Among praise for the challenge, some more progressive scholars criticized the effort as being far too late and incomplete. More conservative critics, on the other hand, had problems understanding the concept and its aim at all. One journalist, for instance, criticized the paintings Natasha Ginwala displayed as being mediocre, very telling judgment as Ginwala wanted to show that these works were not based on Western concepts, which leads to question the yardsticks of this critic. The main question the reviews proposed was, what is the consequence of Hello World? This question, which is very crucial for the success of the whole endeavor, is not that easy to answer, however. Unlike other museums, the National Gallery has a very limited acquisition budget, going close to none, making it impossible to just close gaps in the collection by extensive buying trips. This must not be a bad thing at all, as buying campaigns are also very problematic as they cement old economic and political hierarchies, as Julia Lamoni pointed out in her article Beyond the Global Dream in 2017. I quote, "If museums do not engage in this sort of questioning connection to their position in neoliberal economic globalization, they fail to fully commit to the transnational agenda that they set for themselves. For besides the ownership of the artworks and the inclusion of pieces from many different regions of the world in collections, transnationality and the global should also be problematized from an economic and political perspective as a form of working together as curators, art historians and museums professionals based in different geographical, cultural and political contexts, shaping strategic alliances to share knowledge and resources." End of quote. Against this backdrop, I believe that a more proper and sustainable way would be to start exchanging collections and knowledge among museums and curators. A direct cooperation might, in my eyes, be a right way to realize a future global museum, one which could function on exchange, transformation and sharing on the basis of entangled history or thematic focuses. Thank you very much.